Great. Hi there, guys. We're going to be looking at the challenge of natural hazards over the next series of videos. So it's a bit of revision about the topic. We're going to be having a look at the key aspects of the topic, making sure that you understand all the content and understand how it can be applied to exam questions. So you can follow along using paper, you could use lined paper, you can use plain paper and do a mind map, however you'd like to do it, or you can use the booklet, which it will correspond with. It's up to you how you want to do it, it's however you like. You can also pause and rewind where you like, and I would suggest making as thorough notes as possible. It will be very useful when it comes to your revision. So the first thing we're going to have a look at is the challenge of natural hazards. So I'm going to suggest you write yourself a title. And the first thing that we are going to look at is, what is a natural hazard? So the first thing we have is a natural event. And a natural event is something like a flood. It could be an earthquake, could be a volcano. So a natural event, any of these, and then you have your people and your human activity. When these do not overlap, there is no hazard. So these are not overlapping. You have your natural event and you have your people and your human activity, and that means people are not being affected. So for example, if there was a massive earthquake in Antarctica, people, human activity wouldn't be affected, so it's not deemed a hazard. However, when natural events and people and human activity suddenly merge together and there is an overlap, so that's to say if there is an earthquake in an area where there are people or where there is human activity, this is when it becomes a hazard or a disaster. So what we get is that natural hazard that happens once they have gone from being apart, not affecting each other, to together. So hazard risk, on the other hand, so we'll write this here. So what is hazard risk? Now this is the chance or the probability of being affected by a natural event. If you are living by a river, that might be at risk of flooding, or it floods every single year at the same time, you're probably going to be nearest that 100% chance of being affected by that natural event. If you are living in the United Kingdom, the chance of being affected by an earthquake are very slim. Or if you are living on a fault line, it might be much, much higher. So that is the risk, that's the hazard risk, the chance or the probability of being affected by this natural event. Okay, so the chance of that overlap. We want to know what factors are increasing the risk from natural hazards. There are lots and lots of different ones. So the first one we want to look at is urbanisation. Now, urbanisation is the percentage of people or percentage of population living in a city. And 50% of the world's population now lives in a city, which is extremely high. And this increases the risk factor. So for example, there are countries and cities like Tokyo, which have a very highly densely populated population. And this means that when they have things like earthquakes affecting them, quite a few people will be affected. This is because there's a dense population, so lots of people living in one place. So a really good example of this is the country Haiti, which suffers very often from earthquakes and has a very dense population in their main cities. In 2010, Haiti suffered an extremely large earthquake, and this killed 230,000 people in their main capital, the capital of Port-au-Prince, and this was a very large number for one quite small area. The second risk factor is poverty or uneven development. And in poorer areas of the world, so these are in our LICs, so low-income countries, or your NEEs, which are your newly emerging economies, people are forced to live in those areas where they are at risk. And that is because they can't afford to leave the area. Alternatively, there is a shortage of affordable housing, and then people are led to build on unstable land. So, for example, slopes that are prone to flooding and landslides. And one example of this are the favelas in Rio de Janeiro in Brazil. These are very prone to landslides and extremely densely populated. And if there is a landslide or a landslip, a huge number of people will be affected, whether that's their homes destroyed, whether they're injured, or they can even be killed because of them. The next factor which affects hazard risk is farming. People very often will have farmland near rivers. And this is because when rivers flood, fertile silt is deposited or dropped on its floodplain. And this is perfect to grow crops on because it has lots and lots of nutrients to help plants and crops to grow. But when people choose to live there, they are putting themselves at risk. This is the case in many countries, for example in Bangladesh, where there are many people living near the River Ganges on very low-lying land vulnerable to flooding in order to be able to farm crops. This ties in really nicely with our river deposition landforms. So floodplains are a depositional landform, and the floodplain is a wide flat area of marshy land on either side of the river. And it's found mainly in the middle and the lower courses of the river. And they're made up of sediment, silt or alluvium, which is deposited when the river floods. When the river floods, it deposits silt, which creates the very flat floodplain. And layer upon layer builds up over many years, and that forms a thick deposit of that fertile alluvium. The best way to spot the floodplains on the side of the riverbank is just to see how green the land is, because the crops and the plants and the vegetation can grow so easily with the build-up of that rich fertile sediment. So here you can see that the fertile silt is left once the river flood subsides, and that's just there on the riverbank. And this is what builds up that floodplain. And the final factor which we're going to look at, which affects the risk of natural hazards, is climate change. The world is getting warmer, which leads to more intense and frequent hurricanes and storms because of that increased energy. Some parts of the world are becoming wetter, which increases flood risk. And some areas of the world will have less rainfall and therefore will be prone to droughts, will be prone to wildfires and other natural events. Finally, we're going to recap what are the different types of hazard. And there are a huge range of different natural hazards. So just as a recap, that's natural events and then the people and human activity which the natural event affects. So the first type that we're going to have a look at are the atmospheric natural hazards. And then the second will be the geological natural hazards. Atmospheric hazards include things like hurricanes and storms. They also include the lack of water, so your droughts. And one more example, which is flooding, so when there is too much rainfall or precipitation. And a simple way of defining atmospheric hazards is just as weather conditions. And then we have geological or tectonic hazards. Now, some of those can include violent shaking of the ground, also known as earthquakes. It can be when magma is released from volcanoes, so those are your volcanic eruptions. And finally, we have tsunamis. A common misconception is that a tsunami is an atmospheric hazard because there is water involved, and that is incorrect. Tsunamis are caused by plate movement underneath the ocean. So that is not an atmospheric condition, that is geological. So to recap, any natural hazard caused by the movement of Earth's crust is called a geological or a tectonic hazard. Right, to recap this entire video, there are a few exam and example questions that you might like to try out on your own at home. And remember, if you are trying out an exam question with marks attached, you might like to time 1 minute per mark. And finally, here is a summary of all of the key terms that we have covered today. So you should be able to define these all by heart. So just make sure that you write down any that you are unsure of and you just go back and check to make sure you know the definitions.